Hello everyone and welcome back to the third part of my Kendrick Lamar To Pimp a Butterfly explanation series. Since it's the third episode, I'm sort of getting sick of these intros, so from here on out, I'm going to keep them very brief. In this episode, we'll be analysing the song King Kunta and how it fits into the album and previous songs we've covered. Links to those will be in the I thing at the top and the description. Anyway, let's get into it. Firstly, the title King Kunta is in reference to the character Kunta Kinte, who was in the 18th century novel Roots, written by Alex Haley. This character is used to represent Kendrick's ongoing resilience against the pimping Uncle Sam and the record industry is doing. This is because of the resilience Kunta Kinte shared by doing things like rejecting the name Toby that was given to him by his slave masters. Kendrick labels this character as a king to provide a feeling of empowerment, as well as contrasting the different levels in society. This is also an oxymoron, as the downtrodden slave of Kunta Kinte is matched up with the prestigious title of a king. The song immediately opens up with Kendrick rapping the intro. I got a bone up here. I don't want you monkey mouth motherfucker sitting in my throne again. I'm mad, but I ain't stressing. True friends, one question. This is showing us Kendrick being braggadocious about where he now is in the rap industry after the release of Good Kid, Mad City. By saying he doesn't want people sitting in his throne again is a call out to other rappers at the time like Kanye West or Drake that took the limelight away from Kendrick in the period between Good Kid and the making of T-Pab. The line "I'm mad" is a reference to James Brown's song, The Payback, that is also mentioned later in the song. Revenge! As well as this, the line "I've got a bone to pick" may also tell us Kendrick sees the other rappers as a mere nuisance, almost like a bone stuck in his teeth. It ends off with the line "True friends, one question," which brings us into the chorus. Bitch, where you and I was walking, now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off him. Kunta, black man taking no losses. Oh yeah. Bitch, where you and I was walking, now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Kunta, everybody wanna cut the legs off him. When you got the yams. This is addressing the people that weren't interested in Kendrick before. It starts with, "Bitch, where you when I was walking, now I run the game, got the whole world talking," which is Kendrick saying how he was ignored before and was never given a chance. It may also be a representation of how he had little money, but now that he runs the game and has a lot of money, the people who weren't interested before come out of the woodworks and want to either befriend Kendrick or use him for an ulterior motive. Kendrick also mentions how everybody wanna cut the legs off him, which is in relation to the part of the novel Roots, where Kunta Kinte gets caught trying to escape the slave plantation, which leads to him having his right foot cut off. This may be symbolic of the jealousy people now have towards Kendrick, as they want to cut the legs off him, as in stop giving him a platform so he can't run the game anymore, as mentioned in the previous lines. The chorus ends off with, "When you got the yams, what's the yam?" This line includes an allusion to Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man. The unnamed narrator is walking down the streets of New York City when he smells yams, triggering memories of his hometown in the South. Yam is used as a symbol of authenticity. The protagonist famously declares, "I yam what I am." Here Kendrick is declaring his own authenticity, unlike the rappers he disses in the rest of the verse. Yams are a key ingredient in African cuisine, and have a significance in some parts of Africa as a sign of social status. In his novel Things Fall Apart, Chinua Achebe begins by documenting how a man's worth in Igbo society was largely determined by his yearly yam yield. When Kendrick says he's got the yams, he means he has attained money, power, and prestige. Big butts on healthy ladies and balloons filled with drugs, particularly heroin, are also colloquially known as yams. This leads us into the next verse. The yam is the power that be. You can smell it when I'm walking down the street. Oh yes we can, oh yes we can. I can dig rapping, but a rapper with a ghost rider. What the fuck happened? Oh no, I swore I wouldn't tell. But most of y'all sharing bars like you got to buy the bunk in a two-man sale. Something's in the water. And if I got a brown nose for some gold, then I'd rather be a bum than a motherfucking bum. Oh, yeah. The "I can dig" rapping line is another quote from James Brown's song, The Payback. I can dig rapping. In this part, we can see Kendrick showing an obvious distaste towards people that use a ghostwriter to write their lyrics. Kendrick also cleverly uses a dual meaning of the word bars, by referencing the bars written in a rap verse, as well as bars that would be in a prison cell. Kendrick comments on this in his interview with Rob Markman.
Giant, you do have one line though that where you call out, say I could respect rapping.
Yeah.
With a ghostwriter, man.
Yeah.
Or the rapping.
Yeah.
There was a time when having a ghostwriter in hip hop was a no-no. Like your career was done if that was found out. And I think this generation, we've grown more accepting of it, and it seems like hip hop has gotten past that.
Yeah.
But you seem to draw a line in the sand, and I was wondering what.
All the time. I got in the game ghostwriting, you know, and I know how much work and how much ethic you need behind that. So at the end of the day, it's really about respecting that, respecting these writers, but also as a new artist, you have to stand behind your work, man, and you have to really truly honor the code of hip hop as a new artist. You know, I'm not mentioning the older guys that already laid down the foundations and have the accolades and things like that. The new kids that's coming in this generation, we weren't taught that. You know, we shouldn't be taught that just because the time is new. We need to go in there and be creative as possible. Be creative as possible. And if you do have help, acknowledge the help. You know,
who you seen with a ghostwriter? Can we talk about that?
No, I can't say who I seen with a ghostwriter, but.
I knew you wasn't gonna answer that, but nah, I was like. But it's even like a newer generation.
It's
of
a newer
MCs.
Generation. It's wow. not. It's not even about who. It's the new kids. You know.
Gotcha.
We gotta stand behind that pen and honor your pen, because growth is everything.
In the next line. Something's in the water. Something's in the water. And if I got a brown nose for some gold, then I'd rather be a bum than a motherfucking bum. Oh yeah. First line, something's in the water, is Kendrick again being cautious about the strange behavior he's seeing. This could be towards the previously mentioned ghostwriter situation, or another callback to the shady things going on behind the scenes of the music industry. The other lines tell us that Kendrick will not brown nose anyone or any corporate entity in order to get some gold. He's claiming that if he gets to that point, he'd rather be a bum back in Compton rather than a corporate vessel that is just doing things for money's sake. This reminds us of the title of the album, that we can now see the meaning of more clearly. Kendrick is the butterfly that the record industry is trying to pimp. However, Kendrick is not falling into their manipulative tactics and is standing for what he believes is right. We are then brought back into the chorus and back into the second verse, where Kendrick continues to elaborate on the yams. Bitch, where you and I was walking, now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Coulter, everybody wanna cut the legs off. King Coulter, black man taking no losses. Oh yeah. Bitch, where you and I was walking, now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Coulter, everybody wanna cut the legs off. By saying the yam brought out of Richard Pryor, is Kendrick reminding us of the event when Richard Pryor set himself on fire after using cocaine. As we established before, this analogy is appropriate, as the yam can be representative of drugs as well as big asses. This leads to the second line of manipulated Bill Clinton with desires, which reminds us of the famous situation when Bill Clinton had a supposed affair with Monica Lewinsky. This juxtaposition illustrates that everyone from hood rats to powerful celebrities and political figures can be corrupted by power and addiction. It shows us that although both lifestyles may be drastically different, people always fall for the same things. 24/7, 365 days, times two, I was contemplating getting on stage just to go back to the hood, see my enemy and say, oh yeah. This is Kendrick telling us about the amount of effort he's putting into his work for 2 years. Now that his time has come, he considers going back to his hometown of Compton solely to show people how successful he is, and more primarily the rivals he may have had back in Compton, and the people who previously doubted him. We are then brought back into the chorus, and then brought into the third verse. Bitch, where you and I was walking, now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Compton, everybody wanna cut the legs off. King Compton, black man taking no losses. Oh yeah. Bitch, where you and I was walking, now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King Compton, everybody wanna cut the legs off. You goat mouth.
mouth, mammy fucker.
I was gonna kill a couple rappers, but they did it to themselves. Everybody's suicidal, they didn't even need my help. This shit is elementary, I'd probably go to jail if I shoot at your identity and bounce to the left. Stuck a flag in my city, everybody screaming Compton. I should probably run from mayor when I'm done. To be honest, and I put that on my mama and my baby boo too. 20 million walking out the court, baby, whoa, whoa. Yeah, fuck the judge, I made it past 25. And there I was, a little nappy-headed nigga with the world behind him. Life ain't shit but a fat vagina. Screaming, Annie, are you okay? Annie, are you okay? Limo tinted with the gold plate. Straight from the bottom, it's the belly of the beast. From a peasant to a prince to a motherfucking king. Oh yeah!
The first line,
you goat mouth mammy fuck.
This line may be a homage to the classic Dog Pound track, Smooth.
Golden shower hour early in the morning, wake yo goat mouth ass up.
In Jamaican patois, to be goat mouthed is to be jinxed. In standard English, this line might be you goddamn motherfucker. But a mammy is not a simple mother. The mammy archetype is a familiar and powerful one in American culture. The black women who often took care of white children in the American South. Famous examples include Aunt Chloe in Uncle Tom's Cabin and Hattie McDaniel's character Mammy in Gone with the Wind. Goat Mouth Mammy Fucker is also a modified version of the monkey mouth motherfuckers called out in the verse.
I was gonna kill a couple rappers, but they did it to themselves. Everybody's suicidal, they didn't even need my help.
Kendrick's telling us how he was willing to kill other rappers' careers if they tried to get in the way of his objective of being the king of rap. The next line explains how Kendrick doesn't even need to do this, as by the time he's ready to diss them, they've already shot themselves in the foot by not stepping up their game in the rap industry.
This shit is elementary, I'd probably go to jail if I shoot at your identity and bounce to the left.
The first line tells us Kendrick thinks that writing his own bars and rapping in general is an elementary grade level of difficulty for him. It also has a link to the famous Sherlock Holmes catchphrase.
But how do you know about them?
Elementary, my dear Watson. This man has been dead for at least 2 hours.
As well as that, bouncing to the left could be in relation to how Kunta Kinte's right foot got cut off, therefore he could only bounce to the left.
Stuck a flag in my city, everybody screaming Compton, I should probably run from here when I'm done, to be honest.
This is Kendrick boasting at how after he released Good Kid and left his mark on Compton, it has put Compton back on the map as a location of young rap talent. He claims that he should probably run for mayor due to the support he's given to Compton, as well as the newfound support he's found for himself.
Then I put that on my mama and my baby boo too. 20 million walking out the court, baby, whoa, whoa.
Kendrick references the speakings of Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, who often spoke of 20 million oppressed African Americans. This isn't the first time Kendrick has referenced the number 20 million. As in the song Hole Up, Kendrick says,
I'll probably die in a minute. Just bury me with 20 bitches, 20 million in a countdown fitted. Hold up. Oh yeah, fuck the judge, I made it past 25. And there I was, a little nappy-headed nigga with the world behind him.
The first line is showing Kendrick's obvious distaste for the legal system by saying fuck the judge. This is also supported by the album cover where we can see the dead judge lying on the ground in front of the White House. Kendrick then reminisces on how he made it past 25, which was claimed as uncommon in the Compton area. As well as this, Tupac famously died at age 25, making it a more significant year for Kendrick to make it past.
Life ain't shit but a fat vagina.
This brings us back to the mantra that was introduced in 4-3, that the meaning of life is sex. Kendrick is showing himself as ignorant, but intentionally so. This idea of fucking things is also linked back to how he wanted to fuck over other rappers.
Screaming, Annie, are you okay?
This is in reference to the lyric in Michael Jackson's song, Smooth Criminal. The reference seems pointless now, other than to just reference an artist Kendrick likes. However, Jackson is brought up for a more meaningful appearance later in the album.
Limitinit with the gold plate, straight from the bottom, Mr. Belly at a beast, from a peasant to a prince to a motherfucking king. Oh yeah!
In the final line, Kendrick is telling us the different stages of his career so far. He started off as a peasant in Section 80, turned into a prince in Good Kid, and now as a king in the release of T-Pab. By saying he's in the belly of the beast, is Kendrick telling us that now he's popular, it makes him a bigger target not only for fellow rappers, but also the media and the industry. We are then brought back into the chorus, but this time with a change.
Bitch, where you and I was.
By the time you hear the next pop, the funk shall be within you.
Now I run the game, got the whole world talking.
Kendrick being cut off by the gunshot tells us that the only way Kendrick's rivals will be able to take him down is through the act of violence. Just like a bullet breaking the sound barrier, Kendrick is hitting us with the funk before we can even realize it. We are feeling the music before we hear the sound. It is already inside us as a society. He is just making us realize it. King culture, everybody wanna cut the legs off. King culture, black man taking no loss. Oh yeah. Bitch, where you and I was walking. Now I run a game, got the whole world talking. King culture, everybody wanna cut the legs off. The song ends off with the line "We want the funk" repeated over and over. This is in relation to the famous Parliament song "Give Up the Funk," where they also repeat this same phrase. We want the funk. Finally, we hear the start of a poem that will be gradually revealed throughout the album.
I remember you was conflicted, misusing your influence.
Though confusing at first, each new part of the poem that's revealed represents the theme that Kendrick will be taking in the next song. For example, the line "misusing your influence" tells us that the next track, "Institutionalized," will be about this topic and what relation it has to Kendrick. This concludes King Kunta, as we are brought into the next track, "Institutionalized," which we will analyse in the next episode of our To Pimp a Butterfly analysis. If you enjoyed, a subscription and a like on the video would be much appreciated, and I'll see you guys later.